Recently, there was this tweet by one of the leading actresses of this country, and that tweet paid ode to every woman who, you know, puts her husband's dream before her own dream. But do you think that the whole, you know, idea of feminism has been now distorted? What began as a idea in good faith has now reached an extreme level, because it is also about the choices which a woman make at the end of the day, right? What is your opinion on the backlash which that actress received on social media?
Particularly in a society like India, tradition, your folklore, your mythology, your discourse, tradition actually enslaved women in a manner that they welcome enslavement. The whole notion of chastity, pativrachya, that the greatest glory of a woman is in serving the husband, even if he is an absolute nincompoop, even if he is a rogue. That is what is indoctrinated in our minds. So in such a culture, I don't think it's very wise to emphasize putting the husband's needs or husband's dreams first. As a family, if each partner in a family puts the spouse's needs on equal footing and respects that, that's a good thing. But given Indian context, this appears to be a nice message, but in reality, it is more or less continuing this mental enslavement. There may not be physical or legal enslavement, but there is a cultural and mental enslavement. My mother, my grandmother, and almost everybody of those generations is a victim of that. So it's nice to say there's also Shakti or goddesses are all, you know, great, AO, all those things, but that's somewhat disingenuous when the women's potential is not fulfilled. So at the same time, are we advocating breaking up our families? Certainly not. I truly believe that strong families are our greatest suit as a country. Irrespective of caste and religion, Hindu, Muslim, urban, rural, rich, poor, one of the most enduring things about India that's actually serving us very well is strong family. But the challenge is, will strong family mean enslavement and disproportionate price paid by women? Or it is the family bonds, each having the other's back, but all of us taking collective responsibility and nobody is left behind and everybody's aspirations are fulfilled and everybody gets an opportunity. I think family, in that sense, while you retain the bonds of family, you must modernize the family. We have no right to ask the women to bear the primary burden of the family. You must respect it. See, that goes without saying. We are all free. There are parents who actually sacrificed for their children. They put their career on hold. There are fathers who, after losing a spouse, refused to remarry because they wanted to put the children's future in their own way first. There are mothers who habitually in this country do not remarry if they are widowed or something for children. These are choices, and we must respect those choices. Choices are different from a certain cultural milieu where you impose a way of thinking and a way of doing on the people. There's no real choice, but that's the expectation of them, and any deviation from that is frowned upon. There's a distinction between the two.
India has less than 30% of working age women, that is women between the age group of 25 to 64, engaged in formal work, and men are 80%. So why do you think that is, and how do you think we should address this?
It's an incredibly important question. In that sense, women's participation in workforce is among the lowest in India, in the whole world. But more important, if it is low but there is some improvement, that is okay. But in the recent years, there's actual decline of women's labor participation ratio. And probably India is unique in that respect. I don't know of any other major economy where women's participation in labor force is actually declining. Even Saudi Arabia is not this bad. There's no decline there. I think we must understand in some granular detail. A lot of research is required, but anecdotal evidence suggests that it's not a uniform pattern. The urban, relatively educated, middle class families, the situation is different. The rural and relatively poor families, the situation is different. Happily, we must concede that the urban middle class families increasingly, or even rural middle class families increasingly, are valuing women's education, girls' education, their empowerment, and more are participating in the labor force. May not be equal to boys and men in terms of numbers or in terms of ratio, but it's increasing. That's a very happy thing. But the challenge is, in the poorer sections, actually participation is declining. I think the key reason is one form of Sanskritization. Because most of the poor women, their employment is of a menial kind. It does not give much dignity, it does not give much income. It is a subsistence, survival kind of an income. A domestic worker, domestic help, kitchen staff, or something else. So as families are becoming slightly less poor, it's wrong to say they're becoming prosperous, but slightly less poor, they're not at starvation level. Partly because the economy is improving, though slowly, there is some increase in incomes. Partly because the government's increasingly resort into some short-term welfareism. Therefore, there is no impending starvation. So once they feel that they're not that insecure as they were, I think what's happening in the poorer sections is take out the women from the workforce because of the menial jobs. It's not because the poorer families are opposed to women working. They're opposed to their women working in menial positions, which puts them in a position of subjugation. There is evidence to show that whenever they are given opportunity to work in a more dignified environment, with a more secure wage, without offending their fundamental sense of humanity, then women are participating in workforce in a big way. Take, for instance, a company called Brandex in North Coast Andhra Pradesh, Achutapuram. It's a Sri Lankan company, garment making. They have a tie-up with a global chain. About 22,000 women, poor women, from hundreds of neighboring villages are all employed. They get about 8 to 10,000 rupees wage. It's not a great wage, but still it's a decent wage for rural India today. And it's an honest living, an honorable living. They're given the skills, there are working hours, they're transported from their homes to the workplace and then sent back again. There is a crèche or something else. There's some minimum insurance coverage. So there is some dignity. There is a sense that we are participating in something solid. And the money is going to their bank account or something. So they actually are controlling some assets. And therefore, in the neighboring villages, there's not one woman who is unemployed. Unfortunately, this is one of its kind. If we really shaped policies, built infrastructure, and encouraged investment, such employment in the organized sector with relatively low level skills, giving some decent wages, would have happened on a mega scale. But this happened only in one or two places in the country. Therefore, this is almost entirely the failure of the government and the governing process in shaping policies, encouraging investment or employment generation, particularly in the labor intensive sectors with low skills, because that is where the poor will find employment, most of the poor. It's that failure that is leading to their withdrawal from the participation of labor force, and this is an extremely regressive thing for the country and for these sections and for women in general.
Sir, in the near future, in a family, if a man wants to take a back seat and take care of the family, while the woman wants to work and be the earning member of a family, do you think the society will be mature enough to accept it without being judgmental?
I wish I could tell you no problem. Not only in India, anywhere in the world, even in a country like the United States or Europe, maybe Northern Europe is a little better, but even in so-called rich countries, more progressive countries, more evolved societies, still, it is a little less common than is ordinarily believed for women to be the primary breadwinner and for the man to be primary home care provider. But things are changing. As a matter of choice, some families are making those choices, moving in that direction. I think if we as a society become less intrusive, our problem is we are a very intrusive society. Some parts of it are good. Everybody cares for everybody else, you gossip about others, you talk very intrusive questions about your life, your education, your employment, your marriage. You know, this is very Indian. We don't think there's anything wrong with that. In the West, it's seen as something improper to ask personal questions. We don't have to probably go to that impersonal level as in the West, but I think we must recognize personal boundaries. If we stop being excessively intrusive, respect the boundaries and recognize that each family has their own choices to make. I think to that extent, even if what I have in my heart is not very conducive to modern society, it is not affecting them. But if I think it's my business to butt in, to make comments freely and talk to them and criticize them, then it becomes much more enervating, much more difficult. So at the very least, this sense of personal freedom, respecting the boundaries, and recognizing that whatever be my views, they are entitled to lead their lives and I should shut my mouth. I think if that much at least is inculcated as a larger sense of freedom, that will make it a little easier. But otherwise, in any society it is tough. Because no, the expectation right from childhood, the sense of male domination, what's inculcated in our minds that the male is the primary breadwinner, income earner, that is so pronounced in the human species that it's not going to be changed overnight across the board. All we can hope is that where the enlightened families make choices that they are most comfortable with, if others don't talk too much and then don't intrude too much, I suppose it's a way forward.